everyone. I am Lesego Tlhabi, and I'm here with the leading ladies of Savage Beauty.
Hi, I'm Nthati Moshesh, and I play Grace Bengu, the first one.
Hi, I'm Rosemary Zimu, and I play Sithole Celebe.
Hi, my name is Angela Sithole, and I play Tando, the second wife to Don Bengu.
Hi, my name is Nambitha Ben-Mazwi, and I play the prodigal daughter, Linda Bengu.
Ladies, how are we all doing today?
Good.
Thank you. I'm good, thank you. Thanks for asking. No one ever asks how I am. I'm very good. Okay, ladies, I've brought you here to talk about the standards of beauty, both in the industry, but also personally, and just in general in South Africa, in the conversation of colorism, beauty standards in acting and in South Africa. So I just want to start with a basic question. I feel like it's kind of basic. Nambitha, I'll start with you. When is the first time you truly felt beautiful?
You know, funny enough, I think that's always an evolving moment in a woman's life. As you grow older, you have different journeys, your insecurities, you know, either they become more or less. But funny enough for me, the first time I felt really beautiful was when I cut all my hair off. That was such an unveiling moment
for me.
When
was this?
It was lockdown, peak lockdown, because we didn't have any hairdressers anymore. The upkeep was awful. So it was a home job, you know, it was in the evening and it was my partner and I at the time. And it was just like, let's just do it, you know. And for me, I started to see my cheekbones. I started to see my jawline. I actually just was like, this is me.
And I've known you for a long time as being like the wig girl. So
yes.
I feel like that was a very big moment. It was just your own.
And then obviously, you know, the roles I started taking, I really put that at the forefront of it. I said, I want to be in my short, thick, coiled hair. I want to look as natural as possible. And I have a responsibility to represent, you know, girls who look like me. Yes. And it's funny because people treat you differently the moment you step into your presence, and step into your beauty and unveil yourself. There's a different type of confidence that comes with that.
I actually want to get into that a little bit later because hair is also such an important part of beauty for black women. But Angela, can you please tell us some of your experience of the first time you felt truly beautiful?
Well, I would say there are quite a few times. I think it's also when I cut my hair as well for the first time. Like I did like a brush cut and I've never done that before, you know. Secondly, it was more internal for me than anything. It was when I, you know, started letting go of my insecurities and my doubts about just even the way I look, you know, physically. I started loving myself, loving my, you know, my tummy and it's just everything about me, you know, like slowly. So that was also one of the times, like one of the moments where I felt like beautiful.
Yeah. It's so amazing that it's also like kind of matching. You know, it's all about shaving the hair and letting go of that. Yeah. But we'll again get back to that. Rosemary, how are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm good, thank you. Can you please answer the same question?
Yeah.
I'd like to shave my hair right now. I need to feel this.
But before this, I think it was when I actually got, when I healed from my severe acne. Mm-hmm. Because before the acne, I was never told that I'm beautiful by anybody but like my grandparents, you know? And that really got to me. So when it healed and when the acne was gone, I felt more beautiful and I started forgiving myself also for telling myself that I'm not beautiful because I've got these scars on my face, I've got these lumps and stuff. And I feel like in this industry, it was very hard because that's when I wanted to get into the industry when I had all these pimples. And it was always, oh, her acting is so great, but her skin. So that kind of, it hurt me and I started hurting myself. So yeah, when I healed on the inside too. And that's when the beauty that I felt inside oozed out.
Cool, that's wonderful. Nthati, should I call you Nthati?
Yeah, please do.
Okay.
So for me, I think it was always being affirmed by my father. When you're raised by a father who always makes you feel like you are the most beautiful girl ever. And I think, you know, then having inherited such good skin from my mother, so I've never not felt beautiful. Yeah. Does that make sense? Because it started from a very young age. It's my child is beautiful. So you grow up with a father who's constantly telling you, you're beautiful, you're beautiful, you're beautiful, you're beautiful. My sister, on the other hand, had a different experience, not from father, but from society. So my sister is very dark. My older sister is very dark. So she was called names growing up. She was called Nyamani. She was called very derogatory names. And so she grew up not believing that she's gorgeous. And if you look at my sister, she's very exotic. My friend Mutsabi always says, yo, your older sister is really exotic. But to now be dark-skinned and to be called names throughout your life, and then we would go to like a family gathering and she would always want to hide because now it's, Nyamanukai, where's that dark one? And it's always the name-calling. And if people understood what impact name-calling has on the same way my dad affirmed and told me how beautiful I was, somebody else in the society was making my sister feel not beautiful. And it took her a long time to accept that she's actually beautiful with her dark skin.
I actually want to talk about colorism. I don't want to jump into it too quickly, but now that you've brought it up, it's a great segue. So I see three darker skinned ladies. Obviously, this is not to exclude you, obviously, from the conversation, but colorism is a big issue in South Africa, and especially for me, I've seen it in the acting industry. So how have you guys dealt with the kind of roles you get? Do you feel also, you know, that you're getting roles that are certain type just for dark-skinned women? Because I've seen it in Hollywood, the darker-skinned women get slave or they get strong, independent woman. They don't get to be the soft leading lady, do you know what I mean? So is this something that you've experienced as well in casting in South Africa?
For my generation, to be honest, it's not really that much of an issue because you get cast because you're playing somebody's mother. So your role is pretty much dependent on... So if my child is Angela, chances are then Angela's father has to be a white man. But now if my child is Nambitha, then they'll cast a darker-skinned man. So with my peers or my generation, it's not such an issue, but I see definitely with the younger generation, it's become a thing. If you speak to darker-skinned girls in the industry, it's a real struggle because then it's, but I'm competing with so-and-so and she's lighter, chances are she'll get the roles. Surely that can't be correct.
Okay, cool. So Nambitha, I just wanted to come to you because you've been acting for as long as I can remember, honestly, but I feel you're only really getting your chance in the light now and things are only really moving at that speed in terms of you know, the productions you're in. Do you feel that colorism had something to do with how maybe it took you a little longer than other less talented actresses or just different actresses?
I don't know. I mean, for me, my journey, even in acting, I mean, you know, I studied business science, was in corporate, so it is still a fairly new career. So it started, if I had to pin it, 2016, my acting career. And what I have actually experienced locally, however, because internationally it's been a very different story, is there's a theme of tokenism. So the roles that darkest pigments are playing, or that I'm playing, and there is a trend, and I've actually been looking into it, I'm like, wait, this is starting to sound very familiar, is we tend to be cast not as the wives, not as your leads who are the soft ones, who are the protagonists that the audience is supposed to fall in love with. You almost are made to be the villain. You are almost made to be the secondary role that the audience is not supposed to fall in love with, and not the likable character. So let's say you are the mistress, for example, of the wife and that family. You come in and you break that family down, or you're the irresistible forbidden fruit. Or, as you say, struggling, you know, slave, or have a very battered past, and you are the face of struggle. So the problem with this is you will have someone who's lighter skinned, let's say, and in a leading role. And you're seeing this trend. Well, things are now changing, which is very, very exciting. I mean, hello, yeah. You know.
Yes.
So in this sphere, that tokenism of having a lighter skin, being a lead, having that responsibility of representing the face of black people, you know, that's starting to kind of simmer down because a lighter skinned person can't be breaking barriers for me personally. And that is celebrated.
Although
as we have a black female
disagree with you.
Who has. Do you get what I'm saying? So we're starting to see that change. And I think for me, the first opportunity, if I have to pin it down, was on Happiness Ever After, where it was, oh my gosh, you know, they took me in my most rarest, most rawest, you know, point as far as beauty, and it was a likable character, and it was falling in love with her and so forth. And that, for me, I took with a very big responsibility, because at the forefront, you're having a dark-skinned woman being a protagonist that people are meant to fall in love with. Yeah.
So this specific TV show is you in the lead. I don't know your acting journey too well, worry. But I just wanted to know your struggle. Do you feel also that colorism has ever had a play in how long it took you to maybe get to, you know, this position?
Not how long it took me to get in the position, but which characters I got, yes. There would be a brief that will come in, and sometimes I'll even ask my agent, like, why are you sending me this? Did you see that it says dark-skinned or very light-skinned? Because sometimes these briefs are very specific. And I started in the commercial world, so they were like, okay, it's dark-skinned or nothing. And I'm very much in the middle now, apparently. I'm not dark enough and I'm not light enough. So that's where they've put me. So, yeah, it didn't affect how long it took for me to be in the industry, but it definitely affected the roles that I got.
Okay, not to exclude you from the conversation, so I want to know from you, do you ever feel kind of any kind of preferential treatment or anti-preferential treatment because of the way you look?
Definitely. I think from the very beginning of my acting career, it was, oh, she's light-skinned, so she definitely is going to play this kind of character. So I was put in a box. The Slay Queen, the Gold Digger, because she's light-skinned and she's beautiful and she's, you know, she's got sex appeal and. Fine, cool, I get that. But it was up to me to change that now, to, you know, say that I'm not gonna take this role because this is how you see me. It's fine, I'll get the brief. And the brief that they would send me, they'll think I fit best for this character. It just says, Gold Digger, typical Gold Digger, Slay Queen, who likes money and who likes this and this and that. So, you know, unfortunately for me, I'll say, personally, my experience, I had to work 10 times harder to prove that, listen, I can play other characters besides your typical Gold Digger characters. And it goes beyond colorism now. It's just, for me personally, there's certain roles that I would get where I'd be, you know, cast or, you know, have to audition to play a black character. And I can speak Zulu, you know, I'm colored, I'm half black, half white. And sometimes they would feel like, oh, but she's not black enough. Yeah. You know what I'm trying to say? But I mean, I can do it. I can speak Zulu, I can, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think that for me personally has kind of affected me, you know, for the times I've, for the years I've been in the industry.
Yeah, I feel like everybody has a story, you know, colorism, in my perspective, mostly affects darker-skinned women, but this is also a case of more outside the industry than in the industry. But it is important that Angela's here because I do think that we can't discount, you know, everybody else's perspectives. Also, I wish that, for God's sake, people stop casting me as sassy. You don't have to be sassy all the time just because you plus sass. Okay. Anyway, let's talk about the Eurocentric standards. Now, for me, I want to go outside this industry specifically because we deal with things like in the makeup industry, you can't find foundations in certain shades. Hair-wise, you can't find certain products unless you go outside the suburbs or you go outside certain areas. So have any of you ever struggled with just blackness in general being not included, and but maybe specifically dark-skinned blackness, not being included in the beauty and hair care sort of industries?
Funny enough, I actually did, I don't know if I can mention this, but I did a campaign. So I have my women's empowerment movement, right, which actually was birthed from this very same conversation. So I've been very open with media about being teased for being dark-skinned while I was growing up, how my grandmother entrenched such a strong self-image and self-esteem. And I started to see that the roles I started to play and me being an advocate in a sense, a lot of dark-skinned young girls would start DMing me and opening up and saying, oh my gosh, one actually was on the brink of committing suicide. And she said, you know, she shared her story and one other girl particularly said her family excludes her from family photos because she's the dark one. Whew, okay. Yeah. So, this absolutely broke my heart, right? So I wanted to have a platform where there is a safe space for this. And there was I don't know if I can mention the brand, but...
Don't do that.
The beauty brand was introducing 18 new shades of foundation, particularly birthed out of contouring, right? We are different undertones. I'm a golden undertone, some people are blue undertones. we're complex as dark-skinned women. And in the African continent, they were struggling with the models on fashion weeks. I mean, they were a big brand that was the main sponsor for these things. So the pressure of beauty not being represented, you know, I've had this when I started off, where we would be completely just, you know, powdered up.
And pale.
You'd be pale and you just, and it's just like, I feel awful. But you would have a makeup artist who's not your same skin tone. And that was when we partnered together to talk about the self-esteem issue, representation. And it was such a beautiful story because when I saw those girls getting their makeup done and contouring, it was such a beautiful healing process because finally they found a shade that fits them. Finally they felt beautiful. Finally they actually could get makeup that was for them and thought for them and designed for them. So that, as soon as you said that, it brought that moment for me and seeing it. And, you know, things are different now, thankfully. I don't know, maybe Mom Tati has a bit more stories to share as far as just before, you know, beauty.
Having, like, makeup artists or people who just don't know your skin tone.
And then struggling to find the right foundation, because it's always about foundation. And then not only the makeup, so makeup also goes with lighting. So you would do certain series, TV series. I remember I did a Canadian series, and the DOP was used to take longer with my lighting because he's never actually lit a black skin before. So it became a challenge for him, but of course it took a lot more time. And you realize, sure, we need to be opening up about things like that because it does affect lighting. And Nambitha was saying even earlier that sometimes even the lighting guys struggle with getting her lighting right. So if we, in this country, maybe we need to redesign our lighting. We need to do the Afrocentric design, lighting design to accommodate everybody so nobody is standing out or somebody else is suffering.
Yeah, we've definitely seen that. I mean, recently with the Vogue cover, the British Vogue cover, beautiful models, but to me, they all looked so one-dimensional. And I think it was the thing, like you're saying, with the lighting. So people in this country, especially with a majority black country, really need to focus on lighting black women.
And that's such a big brand.
It's such a big
brand.
It's huge. But it happens all the time. Like, I just see models on covers where I'm like, if this had a black eye or a black lighting person or just more expertise on this skin, and the fact that black skin isn't just one tone. Mm-hmm. You've got shadows here, you've got gold here, you've got, like you said, you're under gold undertone, I'm more yellow, you're more red. Those are different types of lighting. Anyway, let's move on. I wanted to ask, I know you brought it up off camera, but do you guys think that men are involved in the conversations? Because personally, obviously, they do experience colorism, you know? Dark-skinned men get a higher rate of prosecution. They get treated more as dangerous criminals. So they do get that, but I don't feel like they partake in the conversation, but it could just be me. Do you guys think they are involved in the conversation enough or should be getting involved? I'd like to hear from you, Rosemary.
They should be getting involved. They're not involved enough. Sometimes you even feel like, do they care? Do they care? Because I feel like every time I switch on the TV, it's a light-skinned guy, and he's got a six-pack, and he's hot. And obviously, the lighting is great because he's light-skinned. But the dark-skinned guys are struggling to get into the industry. They're struggling to...
Unless they play criminals.
Exactly, unless they are abusive, they have scars on their faces, or they are just models. That's it, because that's where we actually see their beauty with our eyes. They don't have the conversations, though, and I think that they do, because we're kind of tired of seeing the same.
Yeah, also, to be fair, I think they also contribute a lot to it with music videos having all light-skinned girls.
Exactly.
Yeah. Every time they talk about their preferences, it's a yellow bone.
Yeah. So I feel like they actually are the ones who also say what is beautiful and what is not, and it makes women feel insecure. That's why, you know, and sorry to say, that's why some women go and get their skin lightened just to feel more beautiful or, you know...
Or play to the males
require
of them. So take it back to now childhood. So we even had songs. We had wedding songs. It used to go tswang 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 libonengwa wana tswana lele kalad. So which then meant brides must look lighter to be considered beautiful.
Yeah.
So now it's males who are then perpetuating the stereotype or the narrative. So men should be involved, because then in this country, commissioning editors are the ones who are choosing the lighter skinned girls. It's not the casting directors. The casting directors are being briefed. Mm-hmm. You will cast so-and-so. 99% of the chance it will be a lighter skinned girl. So the commissioning editors, the male commissioning editors in this country, need to also listen to this and hear, what about the darker skinned girls?
Mm-hmm. I don't know if I can be spicy and bring up something you shared.
So spicy.
But no, I mean, obviously we know men pin us against each other, right, as women, and they share. I mean, on Twitter, we see it. They're like, but if only it was so-and-so who played this role. They share openly their opinions. But you said something particular, right, where you were cast, well, we were optioned for this lead role as someone's wife, but the lead, the male lead, said, no, I would like a light-skinned person to play my wife. That was an A-lister, obviously, return on investment, you know, it's really riding on him. Producers are like, well, we need to do whatever he wants.
Wow.
So just an example like that, where it's now your male counterparts, your colleagues, is my preference of who I want you to cast as my wife.
That is actually so, wow. That's happened to me before.
It happened to me.
Because I used to be in music videos, and they never wanted to cast the dark-skinned girls. We would be at the back.
Yeah.
Don't wear a bikini. Don't wear that. Don't come close to the artist. When you're eating, the dark-skinned girls were in the other room, and all the artists were with the light-skinned girls because they want colored girls with sleek hair, long hair, you know, like very light-skinned. And I think that's what also just pushed me, because that's where I started in the industry. So I was just like, I don't want to be here. I want to show them that the darker skinned girls need to be in the front.
I think they're also committed to it so much so that they miscast. Because if you look at shows like, you know, My Wife and Kids, and then everybody is black, and then they have the light skinned mixed race daughters. Or, you know, I saw it on Fresh Prince. And actually My Wife and Kids, where they had a dark skin role and they recast it in the second season to be a light skin role. And when she was dark skinned, she was very in your face, attitude, everything.
Mm-hmm.
And then
the
lighter skin actress came in and suddenly she's soft. And so, yeah, we see it a lot in the thing. But I wanted to speak about your show now. Let's get into Savage Beauty. That's what we're here for. Because you did bring up the issue of skin lightening, and without giving away too much of the plot, that is a topic. That's all I will say, I guess. So let's talk about the issue of skin lightening. Is this anything that anyone here has ever thought about investing in or thought about investigating? Don't laugh.
No, girl,
it's an important question.
I am like diehard advocate of dark skin magic, you know, but without obviously, you know, stepping on toes. If that's your preference and you would like to go into skin lightening, by all means, you know, I have friends who do it, so it's fine. But for me, I'm obsessed with dark skin. I absolutely adore it. I praise it. I honor it. It is just chocolate and I want to lick it.
Yes. I think also for me, it's more an issue of, it's not really a thing of preference. It's this thing we're speaking about. If you are getting preferential treatment for being lighter, you want preferential treatment everywhere. Angela, obviously, I don't think this is something that you might have explored yourself. But is there anything that you've thought about, you know, in terms of the skin lightening industry, especially even since playing in this role, in this character?
Well, like, my opinion on it, rather. Look, like she said, I have nothing against people who prefer to go and get it done. If you feel like it's what will make you feel better, go for it, you know. But just personally, I'm not about it. Like, well, not for myself, obviously, but like just for anyone else. You know, I think people should just really embrace, you know, who they are.
How would you look at your bleached friend?
Like the table.
There's other things that I'll do.
No, I'm talking now back to childhood. So you get pigmentation and the skin actually scars. And then we used to call it dichubaba then. And it's a stuff that was highly, highly toxic, and it had hydroquinone in it. And sadly, if you go downtown Joburg, they're still selling the stuff. So the stuff has been banned on paper, but now you still have people who go and buy. Personally, my second nanny, I noticed that her skin was getting slightly lighter. And I said to her, your skin is getting lighter, what's going on? And then I went into her room and I said, show me what you're using. And I realized she's still, and I said, where did you buy it? She says, no, you can buy it, go Marabastad in Pretoria. So this stuff is still out there. It's not the stuff now where you can inject and it's sophisticated stuff. It's a stuff that then your lower LSM is still buying.
I mean, I think
we're not having that conversation where now we're warning our domestic helpers, we're warning our grandmothers, we're warning the older generation that the stuff that you're using, sure, your skin can never recover, and no amount of plastic surgery can even repair that scarred damage or tissue.
Just for us as well, in you know, department stores where everything is skin lightening or lightens and brightens.
Some don't really say that. I've used one by mistake. And it was painful because my skin was so sensitive. And I remember I bought it because on TV, they advertised with a dark-skinned girl and they lied. It burnt my skin so bad. I was so yellow and now I had these acne marks because it was actually for acne. It was horrible. I didn't want to do anything. I didn't want to see anyone. I didn't want to go anywhere. And I literally started buying darker foundation so I could cover up the burns, but it... And it wasn't even written skin lightening or anything like that.
So what have you guys learned about beauty and especially with skin brightening treatments from playing the characters that you play on the show? If, I mean, maybe everyone can go start with you, Nambitha.
What have we learned from just the content of our storytelling?
Of your character specifically, but also of the industry of skin brightening.
I think for Linda, you know, there is a moment on Savage Beauty where it is a conflicting moment. It's actually quite ironic because you see she has a bit of an internal conflict because she is dark-skinned, but yet there is this promotion of skin lightening, you know, and of course, as a businesswoman and an aspiring, you know, heir of the Bengal throne and legacy and so forth, as a business decision, it makes sense. So that confliction of this makes really good business decision, you can make billions and billions and it's flourishing and it's what, you know, the market really wants and where the market isn't, demand meets supply. So it makes complete business sense. But then there is the confliction of who am I and this is what I stand for, but me, myself, I'm dark skin. You know, I would never do this. And yeah, so that's the only moment for me that was a bit of a learning experience, I guess.
Okay, and you, Angela?
I guess, you know, for my character, really, she's just...
She's not bothered.
She's not bothered. She really is in her own world.
We love Angela's character, by the
way. All love Tando.
But in, just in terms of beauty, rather, I would say that for her, you know, it's all internal. You know, it's just like how she would just want to set herself free and just be herself, coming out like into herself. That would make, you know, that's her beauty moment where she felt like maybe I was so pretty. Oh, I guess I don't know. But other than that, everything else, she really is not bothered.
Yeah, I
don't
care. We'll learn from
it. No, honey.
Rosemary, what about your character?
Zinte, I think when it comes to the skin lightening thing, what she has taught me is to heal, honey. Oh my gosh, just heal. You don't need to hurt people because you're hurt. And I feel like the skin lightening thing is a big thing for her because, I mean, it took a lot of people away from her. And... yeah, what she, I don't want to give away too much, but what she does because of all of that just taught me that I need to heal in order to be myself in front of people and to love myself also with my scars, with the burns, with the bald head. Heal, love yourself, and then go out into the world.
Well, that's Nthati.
Well, how do you think I became wealthy as Grace Bengal? So I'm the other side of the spectrum completely. And it's, so I suppose to the manufacturers out there, what's in it for them? It's the moolah.
It's the money.
It's the money. So I echo everything that the beautiful young ladies have said. But for my character,
it's all about the money.
Okay, so lastly, I just want you to maybe have a moment where you look at camera and just speak to younger you or someone who looks like you. You said you've gotten messages, you know, from dark-skinned girls about representation, seeing you on TV. I don't know if you want to say something to those people, just people who see themselves reflected in you. This is your moment. I'll start this side now, because...
You are beautiful exactly as you are. You were created perfectly. You are perfect in any way. It doesn't matter what skin you were born in. You are beautiful. If it means every morning when you wake up, before you brush your teeth, you look in the mirror and you say your name out loud, Nthati Moshesh, you are beautiful exactly as you are. Please do that.
Thank you very much, Rosemary.
Beautiful black child, beautiful black queen. You are beautiful as you are. You are blessed to be who you are and look the way that you are. People want to be like you. They want to look like you. They want to act like you. They want to move like you. So be the change that you want to see in the world.
Thank you for much.
Don't do that. I just want to say that believe in yourself. Be yourself. There's no one else like you. You are saucy. You are gorgeous. You're scrumdelicious. Yeah. And no one can take that away. Believe in yourself. That's all I can say.
Okay. My angel. Yes, you. I want to actually challenge you to take it all off. Take off that makeup. Those lashes, if you have them on. That wig. Maybe shave it all off, if you can. And then really look at yourself. Look at your eyes, your cheekbones, your voluptuous, beautiful lips. That jawline. And really, really look at yourself and see the magic that you are. And make sure you leave with it. Love you.
All right, wonderful messages, ladies. So, ladies, yeah, I wanted to speak about the hair issue because, you know, there is featurism and we'll get there with the big nose and the big lips also being deemed unattractive. But hair seems to be a very big contentious issue with black women. You either have the naturalistas who seem to kind of be a bit judgmental on girls who relax, girls who have weaves, you know, wigs. And on the other side, you have girls who seem like they don't want to have the conversation on going natural. Oh, it's too much to take care of. It's too... So where do you guys stand on the hair issue? And where do you think the conversation needs to go if anyone wants to jump it and feels?
I personally can't do braids because I'm a coward. So I cannot sit in one chair for 8 hours and somebody's doing my hair. So I stopped braiding my hair a long time ago. I've just shaved my hair because I lost my uncle. So culturally, it's what you do. But I'll tell you what, sure, the day I shaved it off, I looked in the mirror and it was like Nthati was being reborn. I looked at myself and I fell in love with myself all over again. And I think the response has been amazing. It's like, yo, you're rocking short hair, you're rocking short hair, you're rocking short hair. I don't think I'm ever gonna grow my hair again.
And you. We're not growing our hair again. I've been cutting my hair every single week. Yeah. For me, though, at first it was so hard. I had dreadlocks. I had my dreadlocks for 7 years, and people did not know what to do with them. And it was painful.
Oh, you can make me cry.
It was so painful to get onto a set, commercial, series, telenovela, and even the black women don't know what to do with your hair. So, Rosemary Zimu used to do her own hair. I used to style my own hair in every show. And it was very painful because they would ask things like, can a wig fit you? No, my dreads are so long. Are you okay with cutting it? No, definitely not for a commercial, come on. But I felt very strongly about this role when they did give it to me as an option. They were like, you can cut it or not. And I said, okay, you know what, let's do it. Let's do it because I know where I want to be in my career. I know that my hair does not make me beautiful because every single casting, every single audition I had to go to, the first thing I used to think about was, does my hair make me look beautiful? And I think I've kind of grown out of that now that I've seen myself and how beautiful I am without the hair. And that's why I'm saying I'm not going to grow my hair again. And I don't judge people with wigs. I own wigs. Mm. I own wigs. I don't wear them as much. But I think we just need to, as black women, we don't need to define our beauty with our hair. Yes, our hair is very beautiful. It's very different. But it doesn't, yeah, exactly. You can do so much with it. So what you have cannot be defining you.
Yeah. You know, like, I'll agree with her as well on that. You know, I just do whatever you want to do, whatever makes you feel good. If you want to wear a wig, wear the wig. If you want to cut your hair, cut your hair, you know? So for me, personally, like, I've been relaxing my hair ever since I was 6. And I've never seen really, like, I've never really seen my natural hair. And I recently cut my hair last year, September. And, you know, because I just wanted to see, like, what does my hair feel like, you know? Because, you know, there's people like, oh, it's going to be curly or what. So I just wanted to try that out, you know? And I'm happy with that. I want to grow my natural hair. I want to try that out. But I'm not going to walk out and be like, oh, you relax your hair. why are you doing that? No, babe, if you want to relax your hair, relax it. I wear wigs. I will braid. I'll do everything that will make me feel comfortable. And it's not about anyone else. It's about myself, you know? So, I mean, she says she's just really happy with the way she looks now. She feels absolutely beautiful. She doesn't feel like she wants to grow her hair back. It doesn't mean she's going to go out there and judge people who wear wigs or whatever. Because she has wigs. Let's do what we want
to
do.
Exactly. So we're so lucky to have all the choices in the world.
Yes.
Let's not judge
How
each other
beautiful
on
is that?
You know what I mean? Nambitha.
I just feel people don't really deserve to have an opinion about you. Yeah. Full stop. You know, for me, it's just like, who gave you the right to even say anything and point at my head? You know, it's your body.
And I don't think other races
it's your choice.
Get it like this.
No, it's so strange. Who actually? Yeah. Like, who? How do you? Where do you find the audacity to say you? Like, for me, it's just mind-boggling. You know, and it just doesn't even end with hair. You know, it with weight or clothes or you should never wear that again. You more suited with this. It's for me. It is just you have no right. Where did you even get that right? Where did you even feel that you could actually fathomly say that?
And the weirdest thing is, when I change my hair, I get treated differently. If I have, like, natural hair, suddenly everyone's like, my sister. If I have, like, a weave, suddenly I'm, like, on the Slay Queen
table.
Yeah.
If you have dreadlocks, you smoke.
But then also, let's
smile out. She likes money.
No, but let's be real. When we change our wigs, guys, our personality changes.
Not really.
No.
Can I just tell you something? Honestly,
I have a wig that literally makes me feel like Sasha Fierce, and I'm like, yes. What do you know what I mean? And then when I have my braids, I feel so regal, and I'm just like, yes, my lineage.
I think
lineage.
It's because you're an actress. Drama.
I knew she was going to say that. I knew it.
But you gave me it. You gave me.
And you do it. You're just not admitting.
No, I just. I'll
and
just,
you have names for your wigs. I know.
I just don't want other people, because then it's also a type of man. If I have a short afro kind of thing, this is the kind of man who's going to come to me. If you have a wig, this is the... It's so boring, guys.
But can you see how it all goes back to, like, a man, right? Like, ooh. If you have
That's
natural
why they need to
hair,
get in this conversation.
If you have natural hair, a man will see it as more like, ooh, this one can be a mama sekaya, the wife. And then a lady with a wig, it's like, oh,
I'm
going to
bless her.
What? Listen, I will wear my wig.
Or even worse, he doesn't want you to wear weaves, and then does he not marry the girl with weaves?
Or cheat with him.
Ooh, that got real quick. Whoever she was talking to, that man who did that to her.
Don't get me started.
No, personally. It's never happened. I've seen it happen.
Nothing personal.
Touching nerves. I love it.
okay, so lastly, what beauty skincare tips do you guys live by? I mean, you know, people have the cucumber, people have skin brightening treatments. What personally, because you all just gorgeous, you don't need me to say it, but you are. What do you all live by? What tips will you not go to sleep without?
Oh, never sleep with makeup. Never, ever, ever. No matter how tired you are, no matter what situation you had last night, babes.
Don't do it.
If you have to carry wipes or... Just do not sleep with makeup on. It will age you, the acne, it's just never.
Angela, must be Angela.
For me, you know, I'm still trying to figure it out. Like, I'm trying out different products. Like, you know, I'm getting advice. To use this product, use that. And then you need to also drink this, you need to eat that. But, you know, all I can say is drink water, guys. Just drink water.
Mind your business.
And mind your business. Besides drinking water and minding my business, something I cannot live without is exfoliator. Every week I have to exfoliate. I cannot miss a week. And sunblock.
Yes.
Ooh, I just jumped on the sunblock thing and I'm like, oh, okay.
Love it.
Yeah.
No, I'm the same. Sunblock, sunblock, sunblock. And I use that like SP 50.
Yeah.
Because it's the sun. I'm not a fan of the sun. And I recently had a medical and my doctor said, oh, vitamin D pills. Yo, that was a shock. Mm. And I thought, no, I need to spend more time in the sun. And it's only 20 minutes that you need. Mm. Skincare regime. Toner, cleanser, and I use the old-fashioned, good old, I'm not allowed to name the brand, but I'm still using the same brand that I used 30 years ago.
Okay, well, you know, please tell me, because
hey?
Black don't crack.
Exactly.
I thought it was always a natural thing until I got to be an adult, and I was like, oh, no, you have to do stuff?
Yeah.
Like, you don't just age like this?
No.
Yes, so people do have in whole some skincare cases, routines.
Yeah,
like
eight things.
And, you know, yeah. I'm not going to lie. Sometimes
I'm so lazy.
That makeup, I'm like, oh, see it in the morning, and it's bad. I'm working on it.
If you go out to the club, sometimes
the
you
club.
Don't have time. Like,
no way. You have to take
after
it all.
After six shots,
I mean, I can do my lashes.
There's only so much you can do.
Are you even able to? I physically cannot sleep.
You must have slept with lashes before and you wake up and it's
like...
I literally will not be able to fall asleep until... And I've done it even when I've napped over at friends' places. I'm like, do you have a wipe? Do you have something?
Yeah, I'll sleep.
It will get better. But I also realise diet is a big one. When things are bad, diet-wise, it shows up on the skin. It's literally like a map of like, oh, McDonald's. Two tequilas.
Yeah. Yeah. Like for me, as well, because I love
chicken
licking. I love sweets, I love chocolate, I love cake. And I was told, Angela, it's time now, because it's going to start, you know, showing pimples. And I'm like, I won't. Next morning, oops, I'm like, oh, all right.
There's a cure for, there's something called a zits blitzer.
Tell me.
What is that?
Oh, no, it's not much, like not even over 50 rand. I discovered this because my son was going out with friends and he's like, Mom, zit, what do I do? Went to a department store, bought this stuff, went, and when it says zits blitzer, it really is a zits blitzer.
Okay.
Because the hormonal
we'll
ones.
We'll
anyway, ladies, we're going into our own personal chats on like, what's the secret? Okay, guys, I'm sure I'm not the only one who's super excited to see Savage Beauty. Where will we be able to see the show?
Only on Netflix.